seated. Welcome to the service today. We've come here to celebrate the life of Lloyd, and some of you drove a lot of miles to get here, so we're glad that God granted you traveling mercies to be able to be here and to show your support and to be with the family during this time. Lloyd was a unique individual who enjoyed life, saw things pretty much as black and white. There weren't too many gray areas in his life. He loved to express his ideas and his opinions. Today we're going to talk about Lloyd's personality and his character and his relationship to the Lord, and also to take a look at our lives and to plan for our future, which I think is extremely important. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, this morning as we call upon you, we call upon you for comfort, we call upon you for strength, for peace, for wisdom, to deal with the loss of a loved one you've called home. Lord, we know that you care deeply about each of us here today. We know where each of us, you know where each of us are on our personal journey through life. You've also made provisions for us to have our sins forgiven, to be a part of the family of God. We're glad that Lloyd had that experience. Today, Father, as we celebrate the life of Lloyd, help us to take inventory of our journey and face the reality of life and death and eternity. Lord, we thank you for the many friends who've come to show their support. We ask, Lord, that you would meet each person's individual need here today. We also ask, Lord, for your guidance and wisdom for this service. So, Lord, whatever good comes out of this service, we want you to receive all honor and glory to yourself. For, Lord, you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. And so we ask your blessing on each person in attendance here today. And we ask this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. This time we'll have two songs by the Calvary Echo Quartet.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul,
with my soul,
it is well, it is well with my soul, my sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when the face shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend, even so, it is well with There is coming a day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace forevermore on that happy golden shore. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. And when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. There'll be no sorrow there, and no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, and no more parting over there. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. And when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. And when he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day that will be. What a day, glorious day that will be.
What a day that will be. Amen. Lloyd H. Yoder, 79, passed away to see his Heavenly Father on January the 23rd, 2017, at Hospice House in Hutchinson. He was born November the 1st, 1937, in Hutchinson to Harry and Barbara Helmuth Yoder. Lloyd was co-owner of Fairview Service Station at Pleasant View for 41 years. He was a member of Maranatha Church here at Hutchinson. Lloyd was involved with the Gideons International. He was a member of the Little Peoples of America and sang for many years on the Kansas Mennonite Chorus and also the Plainview Quartet. On April the 10th, 1965, he married Katie Miller in Hutchinson. They recently celebrated their 51st wedding anniversary. She survives. Other survivors include son Curtis Yoder and wife Tiziana of Naples, Italy, daughter Gail Yoder of Topeka, two brothers, Melvin Yoder and wife Orpha, Harry Yoder and wife Treva, all of Hutchinson, two sisters, Emma Mae Yoder and husband Eli, Katie Irene Hessler and husband Dale, all of Hutchinson, sister-in-law Fanny Yoder of Virginia, five grandchildren, Matthew Warren of Norton, Alexa Yoder of Jacksonville, Florida, Christian Yoder of Aurora, Colorado, Darren Yoder and Katiana Yoder, both of Naples, Italy. He was preceded in death by his parents and a brother, Albert Yoder. Curtis will read a eulogy for us at this time, and after that we will have two more songs by the Calvary Echoes.
Good morning. First off, I'd like to say thank you to all the community and family and friends that have provided so much support over the last few weeks, and especially the support from my mom. Just all that and the prayers have just uplifted our family, and I want to say thank you for that. The man I'm honored to call my father was born in 1937 to Harry and Barbara Yoder of Hutchinson, Kansas. He was a father, a grandfather, a brother, and a friend to many people. He was my mentor and my hero, a big man in a small package, and to me, he was bigger than life. There weren't too many people who didn't seem to know him when I was a young boy. I thought he must be famous. The comment I hear the most is, Lloyd always was upbeat and made me feel happy. Dad grew up on a farm where I hear he did some custom baling for my grandfather. And eventually he purchased Fairview Service with his brothers. And he worked long hours from sunup to sundown. But he always made time to come home for supper. I do remember times when people would be passing through on a holiday and their car would break down, and sure enough, Dad would take off to go help him. And I couldn't always understand that then, but he was teaching me the values of hard work and compassion for others. Dad thought that because he only had an eighth grade education, he wasn't that smart. To me, he was the smartest man on earth. He always taught me to work hard, and he taught me things in the business world that have been invaluable to me in helping me to be successful as well. And many times I would be frustrated when I had to redo something because he insisted on things being done right the first time. He told me you have to be honest with your customers because that is where the return is. He taught me never to give up. And in the end, he was a successful businessman for more than 40 years. Dad often worried that he couldn't do as much with me because he was short. And he said later he was sorry he couldn't spend more time for doing things with me. I thought the world of him, though, and he would take the time to shoot some basketball with me or hit some baseballs until his knees got tired or were hurting. He couldn't always do the things another father could do, but he always, and he thought that, and it hurt him a lot, but he did so much more in other ways that he could never imagine. He used to take me to all the Hutchinson Bronx games where I was able to meet and shag foul balls from the greats like Pete Ladd, Roger Clemens, Pete Incaviglia, Rafael Palmeiro, Barry Bonds, and at the time my favorite baseball player, Wade Odom. We went to nearly all the ball games in those days, and those were the best days of summer a boy could have. Just sitting there in the bleachers of the Bud Detter Field. In the wintertime came basketball, and Dad didn't miss very many Hutch Blue Dragons games, and you may have seen him there. The last few years, his little red chair at the end of the sports arena was kind of a standard. In the spring came the beloved NJCAA basketball tournament, and there's a story that I may not say perfectly, but that I've heard that one year Midland, Texas brought the smallest man in basketball to the tournament. His name was Spud Webb. Such an attraction as a small player as he was stepping off the bus, I guess my dad just couldn't help himself. And he yelled over, "Hey, Spud." Spud Webb looks over and turns and says in astonishment, "Look, I'm not the shortest guy here." Thank you, Harry. Dad loved going to those games, and I loved the time spent with him. Dad was also a great singer, and singing was his passion. His baritone seemed to know no depths. I grew up following Dad around as he sang with the Plainview Quartet and the Kansas Mennonite Men's Chorus. And if that wasn't enough music, then we would sit around the table on a Saturday night and listen to the Grand Ole Opry on an old transistor radio. Some of the first concerts I ever went to see were Marty Robbins and Jerry Clowers, or Statler Brothers and the Oak Ridge Boys out at the State Fair. Any gospel music quartet we could find, and Dad was in his element. It was also a special time to go see the Kansas Mennonite Men's Course in Lindsberg, Kansas, where we could go as a family and enjoy the music. And his love for music and singing became my love for music and singing as well. All this made Dad everything to me, and I haven't even got to the best part. I was adopted by Lloyd and Katie Yoder on June 5th, 1970. He didn't have to choose me, but I was chosen to be part of his family. I don't know what life might have been like back then, but I do know he gave me one gift that I might not know. He taught me from a small child the importance of God in my life, and from the simple power of prayer to the daily devotionals of a family. The gift of eternal life by God's grace is the message my dad taught me, and I consider it a gift, the gift of God in my life. They say big things come in small packages, and I feel God gave me the biggest gift of all, the man of God that I'm honored to call my father. Thank you.
There's a place of dazzling beauty no human eye has ever seen, with gates of pearl and streets paved with gold. It's the land of milk and honey. Oh, it's more than just a dream. It's the land of life beyond the crystal sea. And it's the land of life where living is forever, and where the sting of death will claim no victory. And we are nothing more than just a passing shadow, until we reach the land of living beyond the crystal sea. The sun is nothing but a legend in this paradise of dreams. The Lamb will be the only light we'll need. Its soothing walls of jasper, built with God's own hand. It's the land of life beyond the crystal sea. And it's the land of life where living is forever, and where the sting of death will claim no victory. And we are nothing more than just a passing shadow, until we reach the land of living beyond the crystal sea. Until we reach the land of living beyond the crystal sea.
rejoicing that will be when we all say Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of Him in glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. Sing and shout the victory. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
I guess if that doesn't give you any spiritual goosebumps, you're probably not having a beating heart today. It is a pleasure and a blessing to be able to share and to share about the life of Lloyd. And you've come today to celebrate his life. And Kurt, you did a very good job of representing your father and sharing some of the neat memories. And he was truly a big guy in a little package. And so today we want to reflect on life. Want to reflect on the memories and reflect on the meaning of life. It reminds us that life will not always go on as usual. There are changes that come in life, and we need to adjust and adapt to those. James chapter 4, verse 14 asks a question, and the question says, what is your life? The answer is, you're but a mist or a fog, or as the quartet just sang, a passing shadow. You're here today and you're gone tomorrow. Which means we have a very short time on this earth. And while we may think we have lots of time, time passes by rather quickly for all of us. Psalm 139, verses 13 to 16 says, for you created my inmost being, you knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depth of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. God knew that before Harry and Barbara had Lloyd, that on January the 23rd of 2017, his journey would end here on this life. Psalmist David concludes this psalm with, search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me into the way everlasting. So today, as we've gathered here, we want to do several things. We want to reflect on our life. We want to search our hearts. We want to celebrate Lloyd's life and give tribute to his testimony and conclude with what's really important for life as we know it. Some of my early recollections of Lloyd were when I was a teenager. I was a teenager, and Lloyd was, I thought, a lot older than I was. Come to find out, he was 10 years older. But when you're 16 and somebody else is 26, that looks really old. Even though we grew up in the same community, our paths didn't cross that much, and so I didn't have much interaction with Lloyd until he was in his 20s and I was a teenager. As a 16-year-old looking for entertainment, I have to tell you some of our past. We looked for entertainment as a group of young boys who would get together after hymn sing on a Sunday night or after church service on Sunday night, and we would look for couples who were out on a date. We thought it was our job to entertain them. Entertainment consisted of a variety of things, and one of the things that we did sometimes was putting grease on the car door handles to kind of encourage them, I guess, or jacking up one rear wheel of a car so that when they got ready to leave, it would just sit there and spin and it wouldn't go anywhere. And for some reason or other, the Henry Miller farm was the happening place. And that's where a lot of things took place, and that's where we could almost always find somebody that needed what we thought was our attention. On this particular balmy evening, it was a summer evening, Lloyd and Katie were having a date, and they were with Harold and Betty Miller on a double date. And we got there, and we were going to put some grease on his door handle of his car, but Lloyd was way too alert for us young simmies. And before we got any grease put on anything, Lloyd came bursting out of the south screen door of the Henry Miller house with an amazing speed that only his short legs could move that fast. And I remember we were all in shock and surprise, so us young boys took off. And I don't remember exactly the words that he used, but he had some sound admonition about "die lapihi buba." If you're not German, that's called "you naughty boys." And with that, as we were running, a flashlight passed our heads. We knew that we'd been beat, so we went home. Years later, I sat in Lloyd's office at Fairview, and we were reminiscing about the old days. And as we reminisced, I said, "Lloyd, can you forgive us for the crazy things that we did as young boys?" He chuckled and said, "I forgave you years ago." He said, "I know it was all in fun, and I guess you guys just needed something to do." He said, "If you'd have just had a date, it would have been different." I guess all of us must have heeded that advice because today we're all married. On several occasions, Lloyd called me into his office at Fairview. He wanted to talk about some things. Lloyd always had a very tender conscience, and he was always concerned about how he treated people. And I know on this particular day that he called me in to discuss some things. He wanted to talk about some customers that didn't pay. I can't imagine anybody went to Fairview that didn't pay, but I guess there were a few that didn't want to pay. And so he was talking about how he should handle those, and there were some people that were difficult. But the one thing he would always say after we had discussed these things, he would always say, "I don't want to leave a bad testimony, and I sure don't want to be a stumbling block to anybody. You know what I mean." I said, "Yes, I know what you mean." That was always his concern. So it wasn't, his concern wasn't that he didn't get paid or that there were some people that might not have paid or might have been difficult to work with. He was more concerned about leaving a good testimony and just being the right kind of person. Lloyd loved quartet music. Obviously, that's why the quartet is here today, and that's why Kirk shared about that earlier. He loved to sing, and he spoke very highly of the time when he was able to sing on the Plainview Quartet, as he enjoyed that. In fact, he still had all the equipment when we went to hold their auction before they moved to the Manor. In fact, just in the last couple of weeks, this is one of Lloyd's requests that Clayton's group would come and would sing. He made sure that that was going to happen. And Clayton, he was very proud of you for the life that you've changed, the life that you've turned around, and now you're serving the Lord and singing gospel music. That made Lloyd's day. And he talked about that. He talked about it numerous times. So he was very excited about that. And when you came to the hospice house to sing, that really made his day and made the family's day. And so thank you for doing that. Lloyd also enjoyed good humor. You may not have known that side of him, but he was a Jerry Clower fan to the max, and he could quote line after line, precept upon precept, of Jerry Clower's stories. And I remember, I don't remember when it was, I just remember that Jerry Clower was traveling cross country, and he stopped at the Dutch Kitchen that made Lloyd's entire week. It was really something for him. I remember at one of our church retreats during a talent show, Lloyd took the mic and told us a bunch of jokes and humorous stories. He enjoyed good, clean humor and a good laugh. While Lloyd enjoyed life, there were some things that he lived with that made him very sympathetic with those who were less privileged or those who had some disabilities and some handicaps. I know that's not politically correct, but that's still what we refer to, and he was concerned about those things. On one occasion, he shared some of the things that he endured as a child, and it was tough for him. He said in school, sometimes the kids would make fun of him because he was short, made him feel inferior. So the other day, I asked Kurt if I could have his Bible. I just wanted to go through his Bible and see what he had highlighted. It's always interesting to me to kind of look at a person's Bible and see what was special to them. As I looked through Lloyd's Bible, he had a lot of scripture underlined. A lot of scripture was highlighted. And there were some scriptures that he wrote alongside the Bible on the page, some comments. In fact, in the front of his Bible, I found these instructions. Please read from Psalm 119, 71 to 80 at my passing. So, of course, I had to read it, and I will read it for you today. It was good for me to be afflicted so that I might learn your decrees. The law from your mouth is more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver and gold. Your hands made me inform me, gave me understanding to learn your commands. May those who fear you rejoice when they see me. For I put my hope in your word. I know, O Lord, that your laws are righteous, and in faithfulness you have afflicted me. May your unfailing love be my comfort according to your promise to your servant. Let your compassion come to me that I may live, for your law is my delight. May the arrogant be put to shame for wronging me without cause. But I will meditate on your precept. May those who fear you turn to me, those who understand your statutes. May my heart be blameless toward your decrees, that I may not be put to shame. And then he wrote something interesting alongside that passage of scripture in his Bible, and this is what he wrote, and I quote, "Even though I am short, people have no right to laugh at me. God did not laugh. Instead, he might have said, look what I have made." Isn't that great? Lloyd received his confidence from the Word and from the Word of God. One thing that helped him develop some self-worth, he shared with me that as a young person, and Kurt's already alluded to it, that his father bought a Massey tractor and a baler and sent him out to do custom baling. And he said, you know something? He said, I could bale as good as the next person. He said, I couldn't reach the clutch. I had to jump off the seat and down on the platform to hit the clutch, but I could bale as good as the next person. And he was so excited. He would just relive that, and that was just a number of years ago when he was sharing that with me. Some details about Lloyd's spiritual life. Lloyd, as I said earlier, had a very tender conscience. If the sermon hit home, he would usually say something about it after the service. He would always come to me. On numerous occasions, he asked for prayer for something personal that he was dealing with or struggling with. On Tuesday the 17th, I received a call from Lloyd from his hospital room, and he said, I need to talk to you. He said, can you come up today? I really need to talk to you. Well, I had just been there the day before. I couldn't imagine that there was a lot of change, but I said, yeah, I'll come. There was an urgency in his voice, and so I went to see him. Lloyd wanted to, quote, get some things off of his chest, in his words, and to make sure that he had a clean slate between him and God. He also wanted to rededicate his life. Now, Lloyd's lived a Christian life for a long time, but he wanted to rededicate his life, and he did. Afterward, he said, I feel like a free man. I just feel so good. He said, can I just go home now? And I said, well, you're going to have to wait on the Lord's timing. Several times when I was there to visit him, he said, I am now ready to go. It's taken a load off of my chest. Lloyd not only had that opportunity, but he took that opportunity to make sure that he was ready when God called him. I was privileged to be a part of that event in Lloyd's life. As I left the hospital that day, I couldn't help but think, what if everybody in this community, what if everybody in this family, what if everybody in our church had the same urgency to make sure that they were right with the Lord Isn't that something? It would change our community. I'm not saying people aren't right with the Lord. I'm just saying if there was an urgency to make sure, it would change the way we do things sometimes. Lloyd talked about the peace he experienced for several days after that, even up to the point where he could no longer communicate nor respond to those around him. That's why the Bible says in Psalm 116, verse 15, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints." God is waiting to welcome home those who have followed him throughout his life, their life. God calls it precious, and precious is kind of a unique word because precious is something, when we think about something being precious, it's very valuable. We often refer to gold as a precious metal. To God, his saints are more valuable than 100 pounds of gold. In fact, earlier we read from Psalm 119, where it says, "More precious than thousands of pieces of silver and gold." Thousands of pieces of silver and gold. According to my Bible, there's a celebration every time that a sinner repents. But I think there's also a celebration that every time that God welcomes home one of his children, there is a celebration. And they rejoice. Every believer, when he dies, is carried by the angels into the presence of the Lord. How do we know that it to be true? Luke chapter 16 and verse 23 is a story of Lazarus and the rich man. The rich man, it says, "The time came when Lazarus died, and the angels carried him to Abraham's side." In the same passage, it talks about how the rich man in hell could see across the great chasm or gulf, and he could see across, and he could see where Lazarus was by Abraham's side. So not only could he see, but he could see that he'd missed out on a lot of things. Not only did the rich man comment about the torment in hell, but he asked for Lazarus to dip his finger in water to cool my tongue. But I think more than that, there was that constant reminder for the rich man of what he missed, what he could have had. And I think that's part of the torment of just knowing what is missed. What would have happened? Could he have gone to heaven? Heaven is a real place with some very detailed description we read in Revelation 21 and 22, but hell is also a real place. According to Revelation 20, the last verse concludes with the words, "If anyone's name was not found written in the Lamb's Book of Life, he was thrown into the lake of fire." Lloyd was very keenly aware of those verses, and he wanted to make sure that he was right with the Lord and that his name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life. In fact, one of the last times we talked to him, he talked about his name being written there. For the believer who has accepted salvation by faith, they need not fear because you are part of the family of God. And Kurt, there's another adoption agency that's even better than the one you experienced. So we are adopted into the family of God, which makes us one of his children. The Bible is clear that you can know for sure in 1 John 5, verse 13 says, "I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life." You can know. The Bible makes it clear that we've all sinned. Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And Romans 3 and verse 10 says, "There is no one righteous, not one." You know, the amazing thing is you can't buy your way into heaven, you can't work your way into heaven, and you can't talk your way into heaven. You've got to accept grace, God's amazing grace, as a free gift. You must repent and surrender your life and follow him. Romans 10:9 says, "If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God hath raised him from the dead, you will be saved." John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." It's so simple. A child can understand it. In John 14, Jesus was talking to his disciples before he left, and he had some instructions for them because obviously they were concerned about what was going to happen. And we read these words, "Do not let your heart be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me so that where I am, you may be also." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know the way, so how can we know the way? We don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" And Jesus answered with these amazing words, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. Contrary to popular beliefs today, not all roads lead to heaven. Today there's a lot of people who think all kinds of religions and all kinds of things will lead to heaven. I'm here to tell you the Bible is true. God is true. God is love. And Jesus said, no man comes to the Father except through him. So not all roads lead to heaven. Don't go for that line. We believe the Lord will return for all of us soon. We refer to it as the second coming. We talked about Psalm 139 earlier. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. God knows when each one of us here today, when our time is up. He already knows that. We don't know that. We don't know when that time will be. And I know toward the end, every time I'd see Lloyd, he said, I'm just ready to go. Can I just go now? I said, no, you cannot go now. It's all in the Lord's hands. And on one occasion, he said, would you please tell him to just hurry up a little bit? He just wanted to go. God has your life all mapped out and planned, and he knows when our time here on this earth is over. All we have to do is be ready when he calls our name. Lloyd was ready, and he told me on every visit, I'm ready to go. With his constant pain and his cancer, he really wanted to go home. Romans 8, verses 38 and 39 were some of Lloyd's favorite scriptures. These were also some in his Bible that he had highlighted. It reads like this, for I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor demons, nor present, nor the future, nor any power, neither height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The day that Lloyd rededicated his life, I quoted to him Psalm 103, where it talks about our sins are removed as far as the east is from the west. And I said, the Lord remembers your sin no more. And with that, Lloyd clapped his hands. It was a celebration to him. He just couldn't help himself. He had a real time of celebration. So today, as we celebrate the life of Lloyd and the confidence he had that his name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life, the question we must ask ourselves is, am I prepared to meet my Maker? Is there something in my life that needs to be dealt with? Lloyd did that, and it gave him a real peace. If you don't have that peace, then I would suggest you talk to me after the service. I want to make sure that you have that same assurance that Lloyd had, because he would not want anybody to miss heaven. He wants everybody to have that same assurance. As we conclude this time of thinking about Lloyd and thinking about the life hereafter and thinking about us here today, I just want to say to the family and to Katie, God bless you as you make the adjustments. That apartment's going to be a little bit bigger than it was, and it's going to be a little quieter than it was, and I have to tell you, it's probably going to be a little lonelier than it was. But trust in the Lord and rely on his strength, and he will see you through. The Curtis, your trips home to Kansas are going to be a little different. It's not going to be the same. There's going to be a vacancy there. There's going to be a difference there. But I know that in your heart, you're looking forward to seeing Dad someday. So as you make those adjustments, it's my prayer that you make him, by the grace of God, understand that God's timing is perfect, and that he will work all things out in due time. So may God bless you as you make those adjustments. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, this morning we thank you so much for your love for us. We thank you, Father, for the confidence that we can have. Thank you, Lord, for just providing for us the plan of salvation that we can know for sure that we have eternal life. Thank you, Lord, for the legacy that Lloyd left behind and his testimony and his tender conscience and how he wanted to make sure that everything was right between him and you. And when that happened, he was so ready to go. Lord, today, there are many of us here, and I can't see in the hearts and lives of each person, but you can. You know, Father, whether we have a clean slate or whether there's something standing in our way. Lord, if there's a barrier between us and you, in anybody's life here today, I ask, Lord, that you would remove that barrier. If there's anyone here who doesn't know what it means to be born again, what it means to have their sins removed as far as the east is from the west, Lord, I pray that today they would discover that truth and to recognize that not all roads lead to heaven, but as Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And so I pray, God, that you would give grace, peace, and comfort, especially to Katie and to Kurt and the family and the extended family, brothers and sisters and all those involved. Lord, I ask that you would be with them in a special way. Thank you, Lord, for what you've done for us. Thank you for the life of Lloyd. Thank you, Father, for the challenges that we can receive from that. Help us to be all that we can be. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus. And all the people said, amen. The family will move directly to the graveside for the committal, and the noon meal is going to be served immediately following that. You're all invited to stay for the noon meal. It is cold out there, so we'll move out, we'll do the committal, and then we'll bring the family right back in where it's nice and warm, where you can greet the family inside rather than standing out there in the cold. So we'll try to make room for the family to come back in right away. Also, the family would like to thank you for all of your kindness, for the food, for each person who helped in a lot of different ways today and the previous days. So they want to say thank you to all of you. But you are invited to stay for the noon meal, and we would love to have you do that. At this time, we'll turn it over to our funeral director.